So first of all, thanks for the invitation. It's actually my first time in this beautiful place. I think it's better late than never. Very happy to have discovered this place. And so today I'm going to talk about joint work with Douglas Lundholm, who is in Stockholm at KTH. And maybe since this is an interdisciplinary conference, I should announce the color. I'm a mathematician, but lots of this talk is about physics, actually, or actually our view of certain physics. And so it's about so-called anions, which are exotic particles, more precisely particles with an exotic statistics. So I'm going to explain you what that means in a first part, which is an informal introduction as to on the subject of anions, what is an anion, or actually what is a system of anions. And it's important that I'm going to talk about 2D anions. As we will see, there are no 3D anions, and I'm just excluding 1D anions. Then there is a second part, which is not mathematically rigorous, contrary to what I'm usually doing. It's about explaining you a new argument that we have with Douglas to explain how these quasi-particles could emerge in actual real life. By real life, I mean in experiments done in the lab. And then the third part is about discussing effective models for these things, because as we will see, they are pretty complicated objects from an analysis point of view, so there is a need for effective models to compare with experiments. So let me get now started with part one, explaining you what are anions. But actually, anions are defined by what they are not. Namely, they are not bosons and they are not fermions. So what you learn in school is that there are only two types of fundamental particles in nature, fermions and bosons. For example, electrons would be fermions and photons would be bosons. And, an anion is something which is neither of the two. And that should be a sort of challenging thing, because you should remember that, there should be only these two types of particles, bosons and fermions. So one thing is that it's an experimental fact that we see basically only bosons and fermions, but there is also a very sound theoretical framework to tell you, yes, you only have bosons and fermions. So let me quickly brush over this, just to tell you that this general belief that you have only bosons and fermions is certainly not something you should trifle with lightly. So I'm thinking of n quantum particles in RD, so in a physical space. So they live in the space, D can be 1, 2, or 3. I mean, these are the only physically relevant cases. So these are space dimensions. And I want to have a quantum description of that. Then you start with a classical description by saying what is your classical configuration space where this system lives. And you usually say the classical configuration space is just RD to the n. Namely, you specify, you are looking at an element of this, which would be the n tuple of the positions of your n classical particles. So x1 is position of particle 1, etc. And let me introduce a notation that we'll use through the talk. This collection here I will call x, capital X index n. Then you want your quantum configuration space, and it's basically the axiom of quantum mechanics that you are looking at a wave function psi n, which is square integrable on your configuration space. So I hope this notation is okay for everyone. L2 just means it's square integrable, and maybe I will specify that it is complex valued. And you want that to be normalized. Oh, simply because another postulate of quantum mechanics is that psi n squared is a probability density for having particle 1 at x1, particle 2 at x2, etc. So it's a probability density, it must integrate to 1, right? But that's not the whole story, because in real life, particles are indistinguishable. So if you make an experiment with electrons, if you have a detector which clicks when an electron hits your detector, it's not going to tell you whether it's electron 1, electron 2, or electron 10. I mean, that is just nonsense. So it means that here, I have to somehow symmetrize this guy, and there is some redundancy in these things. I mean, the physical description is not x1 to xn, it's x1 to xn up to permutations somehow. And how do you introduce that? So I need a little bit of notation. Let me take sigma, a permutation of n indices. So this capital sigma n will be always the permutation group for me. Let me define the unitary associated with sigma, which takes psi n if I act on a function x of x1, xn. It returns me the function where I have permuted the indices. Right, so this is just notation. And now, what indistinguishable means, let me state this as a lemma, because this part at least is mathematically rigorous. So it's a well-known thing, I'm not going to try to attribute it to somebody in particular. Suppose that for all observable, let me write it like that. So A is an observable, so think of a bounded operator on your classical, in your quantum space. Suppose for all these observables, for all permutations, you demand that if you look at the expectation value of the observable A in the state psi n when you permute the variables, you demand that this is just the same as when you don't permute the variables. Okay, this is indistinguishability because all your experiments in quantum mechanics are represented by a bounded operator, not necessarily bounded, but at least all bounded operators in principle corresponds to a measurement, an experiment, and you are asking that whatever the measurement you make, the outcome cannot depend on the way you have numbered the particles. Okay, so that's the assumption, and then the conclusion of the lemma is, then, you have two choices. Either u sigma of psi n is equal to psi n for all permutations, or u sigma of psi n is minus 1 to the signature of sigma times psi n. So that's a true fact. And in this case, you have bosons. In this case, you have fermions. Okay. So then there is not much room for anything else, right? You make.
Is there a conditional assumption that actually?
Maybe we can use the microphone only for the later questions, because otherwise it's going to be a little bit.
Well, I was just wondering whether you are not assuming here that U is a representation of the group, of the symmetry group, because if otherwise I'm not sure you can do this.
No. This implies that U is a representation of the group, actually.
It does?
Yeah. Well, okay. Each time I give this talk, somebody asks me the question and I tell you, yes, it does, but then I also tell you that I'm going to explain, I could explain this to you after, because.
No, but I mean, you have defined, okay, oh, I see. It is this particular U, you have defined your.
Yeah,
your
I'm
unitaries.
Defining U this right. way, yes.
So the assumption is in the definition of U.
Yeah, okay.
Right, okay.
Say it like that, yes, I could state it like that. Okay, so there are only bosons and fermions, right? Because if you demand this, which is the basic physical postulate, you should by all means put in your theory you can have only bosons and fermions. So end of the story. End of the story, not quite. So let me, I'm going to use the other board because I would like to keep this, what I'm going to say on board. So this was the end of the stories, of the story up until basically the end of the 70s, when some people arrived and said, you might be doing this wrong. Namely, you might be quantizing your theory in a wrong way. So how could that be possibly? Could that be possible? Because here, I have no Hamiltonian, I have made no choice as to how you represent operators, I have not tried to prove that anything is self-adjoint or whatever. I have just described the configuration space. But there is one choice I've made here, and these people came and said, well, this choice is not obviously correct. And this choice is, whoops, I have first quantized and then symmetrized. Let me explain you a little bit. So now I come to how do you go about thinking of anions. And here this is due to Leinas and Murheim in 77. Then there is also an important paper of Vilcek, which has a slightly different point of view on this in 82. And there is an important precursor in Girardot, 65. Basically, I'm using this point of view here. And what they say is that you should first symmetrize your classical theory, and only then you should quantize it. Because here, what I've done is that I have no symmetry in my classical configuration space. I quantize by introducing wave functions, and then I symmetrize by using that lemma over there. And what they say is that your classical configuration space is not R the full of RDN. It should be, let me denote this CND. It should be, you take RDN, you remove the diagonals. So this notation here means that I'm removing for the from the configuration space configurations when two particles collide. And then, importantly, I take the quotient by the permutation group. So I identify configurations that differ just by a permutation. And then your quantum space should be L2 of this complicated thing with appropriate gluing conditions that I'm going to brush under the carpet for this talk. And then I'm not going to go through the derivation for lack of competence and lack of time, but this changes things dramatically, at least in 2D. Because this guy here has a non-trivial topology in 2D. So I'm not going to explain how that comes about. I'm not sure I could, actually. What I'm going to tell you is that the main difference is that you take 3D space, you remove a point, that is simply connected. You take a plane, you remove a point that is not simply connected. And this makes a huge, huge difference when you want to describe a theory like that. So let's see about the blackboard management. Yeah. So to make a long story short, what these people found is that if your space dimension is larger than 3, you get the conventional answer that you have only bosons and fermions. But if d equals 2, so I'm not dealing with d equals 1 because it's a special case, but if d equals 2, you have a logical possibility for having anions, namely particles which would have any statistics. So you have a possibility, namely it's just that it's not contradictory with your assumptions, that if you act with u sigma on psi n, you get e to the I pi some alpha to the signature of sigma times psi n. Well, now alpha is allowed to be any real number. But by periodicity, you can just take it between 0 and 2, and the bosons would be alpha equals 0, fermions would be alpha equals 1. Okay, so far so good. This is a logical possibility. And this is the possibility here that I want to discuss in today's talk. And there are lots of problems with this. Let me first deal with the first one. This is not a function, because this is not single valued. If alpha is not 0 or 1, say you just interchange two indices, then you get e to the I pi alpha. Then you interchange them back, so you should go back to the original point, but then you get e to the 2 I pi alpha. And if this is not 1, your wave function is not single valued. So this is not a wave function because it's not single valued. So the way out is well known, is that this is not a wave function, this is a line bundle over the configuration space. But I'm not going to use this description because it's not very wieldy to do analysis. And I'm now confessing I am an analyst. So I'm going to use a formal transformation to somehow encode this in a way of which I can say something with my preferred tools. And this is called the magnetic gauge picture. So this again is as old as the Enyon concept, so you could find this in these papers. So the idea is, I don't want this wave function, which is not a wave function, so I'm going to formally say that psi n is a product for all indices different of e to the I pi alpha, the angle of the vector xi minus xj, times some other function phi n. So the arg of xi minus xj is the angle in the plane of xi minus xj. Yes?
Sorry, just before you go on, something I don't understand over this level, because let's see, up here,
yeah.
Before you didn't simplify as a start off, your cn is an L2 of r dn, so I understand what permutation means. Mm-hmm. Over here,
yeah. Yeah, so it's a good point. So the true statement would be that this psi n should be a function over this C and D with gluing conditions. And then it turns out that with your gluing condition, you can represent it as a function over RDN, provided you have this. So actually, you can represent it as a line bundle over RDN.
Okay, so it's not really L2 because
yeah, so as I said, this is introductory, so I'm a little bit sloppy. I mean, okay.
Sure,
so it's not quite L2, yes. You have to specify gluing.
So, for example,
so in this description, I have taken out the funny alpha statistics in this factor here. And then this guy here has bosonic symmetry. This guy is bosonic, it has alpha equal to 0. So, this is a genuine wave function I can work with. And the idea is that I'm going to act on that with an Hamiltonian, and I want to think not in terms of psi n, but of phi n. So how does it go? Let me take a Hamiltonian, a standard one. Let me take mass equal 1. Let me just take non-relativistic kinetic energy, so this is momentum, canonical momentum, and let me take a Schrodinger operator with a potential v of xj. Let me recall that P is minus I gradient. And when I put an index j, it means that it acts on the xj variable. Okay? And then something you can do, you can compute. Is that if you take the expectation value of this Hamiltonian, so this is a completely formal expression, right? So let me put quotation marks here. This is, you can represent it as something acting now on your bosonic wave function phi n with an effective Hamiltonian that I'm going to call hn alpha. And hn alpha has a very particular form. So it, namely, it's like this. You have modified your dispersion relation here. So you get Pj plus alpha, some vector potential that I denote with an index A to say that it refers to anion of xj squared, and then the v of xj doesn't change. And so who is this A? This A vector potential. A of xj is a sum over all other particles, so not xj, of xj minus xk up over xj minus xk squared. Right? So what does this mean? So you take the vector xj minus xk to get xj minus xk up, you just rotate it by pi over 2. And then you divide by the norm squared. So this has a norm which is 1 over the norm of xj minus xk, and the direction is perpendicular to xj minus xk. And I have a little bit of space here, so let me draw something. This, what does it mean physically? It means that you can describe these anions as bosons that carry a unit of magnetic flux. So an Aronoff-Bohm unit of flux, actually, if you want to have the buzzword. So let me describe this schematically by saying this is the plane. I have particles that live here, say x1 at position x1, x2, x3. And attached to each of them, I have a unit of flux, magnetic flux. So let me say that is B. This is a magnetic field that would be perpendicular to the plane. So why am I saying this? Because if you take the curl of that to get the magnetic field, you can compute that this gives you a sum of delta functions located at the xk. All right. So this is the description I'm going to use. Actually, this one, I don't know. First, I don't know exactly how to make sense of it and how to do computations with it. And also, I don't know how to make it emerge from an actual system. Whereas this one, I know how to. So this is going to be the second part. Now I'm starting the second part. So let me put this upstairs and keep it through during the talk. So if ever I try to erase that blackboard, please scream, because I will have to refer to it several times. Then this one goes down. No. So the second part is about addressing or trying to address other issues linked with this concept. Namely, fine, you said there is a logical possibility for having exotic statistics in 2D. But first, you have said nothing about does this actually occur in real life? Why would not you have only bosons and fermions still? I mean, you never find a non-trivial alpha. And second, more importantly, actual particles are 3D, okay? So all fundamental particles are 3D, at least in my condensed matter physics world. So this cannot occur, right? Even if you trap particles in 2D, like as we learned in the previous talk, this is something physicists can do in the lab, these are still 3D particles just forced to live in 2D. So the statistics is still the 3D one. So you need some non-trivial ID to obtain anions, if you want to obtain some. And I'm going to explain what I think is the most serious proposal in the literature. So there are other proposals, but I'm going to explain what I think is the most likely to happen someday soon. And this is our anions in quantum Hall physics. So basically, the idea is that I will have particles that will bind to vortices in a non-trivial way that will make this particular vector potential occur. Yes. So it's not going to be exactly quantum Hall physics as discussed in the previous talk. It's going to be a thought experiment which, if it could be realized, would be most likely to be realized with cold atoms, where you have a lot of tunability of parameters. But let me keep this at the level of a thought experiment, which pompously I'm going to call tracer particles in a Larkin liquid. So first thing first, this, we are not the first to come up with this idea. There are two papers, one by Cooper and Simon, 2014 for the preprint, I guess, maybe 2015 for the actual paper in PRL, but who cares? And then Zhang. Srijis, Gemelke, and Jane, also 2014 or 2015. And we have revisited this with Douglas, so let me revisit it in my more mathematically oriented way. I'm thinking of two types of particles. The main idea is that you have one majority species that form a particular state. The other species couples to this state, gets dressed by it, and then out of this, fractional statistics can emerge. So a little bit of formalism. My Hilbert space will be L2 symmetrized of R to the 2M, so particles in 2D, cross, I mean, a tensor product with L2 symmetrized of R to N. So here, for simplicity, I'm starting with both types of particles or bosons originally, but this doesn't matter in the derivation. I mean, you could change this for anti-symmetric or anti-symmetric, and I could do the same. So these guys I will refer to as the tracers, and they will become anions, and this guy I refer to as the bath particles. So I'm really thinking of a huge bath of these guys and a few of those other guys in it. And let's get the notation precise. So I'm looking for a wave function psi of xm and yn in this space. So xm are the coordinates of the first particle. This function has to be invariant under permutations of the indices here. Yn are the positions of the y of these other particles, and I have to be invariant under permutation of those, but I do not impose anything on permutation between the x and the y's, because here I have just a simple tensor product. Then I'm going to write an Hamiltonian for that system. So a full Hamiltonian will be one part acting only on the tracers, one part acting only on the bath, and then an interaction. Let me call it W12 because this is the interspecies interaction. So this is interaction between bath and tracers. They interact with each other, otherwise it's not interesting. Then this Hamiltonian here, HM is usual many-body Hamiltonian. I will keep the mass parameter for the tracer particles, so usual momentum, and I put an external magnetic field. Let me call it AX. And I could add a trapping potential if you like. But let's keep these things simple. So I mass charge, I'm going to write down what this is soon. HN is the same. Except, so this is momentum in xj, right? He said that I will set mass and charge equal to 1 for reference. Same external potential. Sorry, I'm forgetting that I have to put also an interaction, so a double sum of W11 xj minus xi, say. Here I also put an interaction between the bath particles, so sum over k and l of W22 yk minus yl. And I think that's it. I just have to specify that I'm thinking of a uniform external applied field, magnetic field. My convention is that it goes downwards, and I'm losing the Landau gauge. No, the symmetric gauge, sorry. So B is the value of an applied magnetic field, could be artificial. For example, in cold atoms, you can have artificial magnetic fields. I have repulsion between all these guys' interactions are repulsive. And I'm going to consider this guy in a very particular regime, a very stringent one, actually. So which board will I use? Yeah, let's go here. So I'm interested basically in the ground state of that. Okay, what is the minimal energy configuration in this? And then I want to put assumptions on the energy scales. They are very stringent. I know. You don't need to tell me. But I think you cannot really dispense of these assumptions if you want to obtain emergent fractional statistics. So I'm first assuming the first energy scale is set by the magnetic field B. And you see, this magnetic field B gives me what is the gap of this one particle Hamiltonian here. So this means, by this I want to say that the bath particles are going to be forced by this huge magnetic field to leave in the, let me write it LLL, lowest Landau level of the magnetic Hamiltonian. So what does that mean? The LLL is just the functions psi of z, which are an analytic function of z times e to the minus b z squared over 4, I guess, give or take a factor of 2, where f is analytic. Okay, so a few comments. Here I'm identifying complex numbers and coordinates in the plane, as usual. And well, this space here, as I guess most of you know, there are no squares here. Yeah. As most of you know, this is the ground eigenspace for that guy. So I'm saying the magnetic field is so huge that all the bath particles want to minimize the magnetic kinetic energy by sitting in this space. Then two, I'm going to assume that the next energy scale is that this W22 potential here is badly repulsive, so that the bath particles want to avoid one another. So I'm just going to write it formally, that this W22 is repulsive, and I'm assuming that it's short range somehow. I'm going to explain to you in a minute why. And then, third energy scale, I'm assuming that W12 is also badly repulsive and also short range. So namely, also the bath and the tracer particles want to avoid one another. And then four goes all the rest. So namely, all the rest I don't put assumptions on. Okay? Then what I'm going to argue is that under this very stringent condition, there is a natural ersatz that emerges for choosing the ground states of this Hamiltonian. So this is the next step. This is the first. Can you still see the down part? So let me write the ansatz and then comment it. So the ansatz for my full wave function psi of the two sets of variables. So it's a long story to write. So it's psi of xm yn is a phi only of xm. So just a wave function, bosonic wave functions only for the particles, the tracer particles. Then how to write it? Yeah, a psi that I call QH for quasi all of XM NYN. Well, this psi QH of XM NYN is a C of XM, which is just a normalization constant that you should not worry too much about. Then a product from J is 1 to M and K 1 to N of zeta J minus ZK times the Laughlin wave function. I'm going to explain you what that is, only of the YNs. Where here, zeta J is a complex number that I identify with XJ, which lives in the plane. ZK is the same, but it's identified with YK. And then I still have to tell you, let's see, what the Laughlin state is, Laughlin of YM, YN, yes. It's a product over all pairs of Bass particles of ZI minus ZJ to a power N, where N is an integer, times a Gaussian factor minus B over 4 sum of Z J squared J from 1 to N. Okay, so that's the ansatz. And the claim, which is not mathematically rigorous in what I do, is that this is a good approximation for the ground state of the full system in this regime here. So let me comment a little bit on as to why that might be true. So the first thing is that for the movement of the YM particles, they all have to be in the lowest Landau level. So namely, they all are, I mean, the only single particles orbitals that I'm allowing for the Ys are of this form, analytic times Gaussian. And if you check, this is analytic times Gaussian in the Y variables. Gaussian is over there. This is analytic, this is a polynomial in Z. And this is analytic also. Then second thing, and this is really where, I mean, I think it's really good to appreciate that when you have this constraint and then the constraint of strong short-range interactions, the two conspire together to create a very particular form. This, I assume, forces the wave function to vanish whenever two Bass particles encounter. But then the wave function has to be somehow analytic. So it cannot vanish any way it likes. First, it's because of the magnetic field in the very strong, the plane has now an orientation. And then things have to be analytic, so they can vanish only as a polynomial. And this is my parameter here. So the wave function vanishes as a polynomial when two Bass particles encounter. And then you will notice that they vanish with a phase circulation because the magnetic field gives me an orientation in the plane. And so this is attaching vortices to particles. Right? Let's stay vague about this, but this attaches the phase singularities to the location of particles. Then third energy scale, same scenario. The wave function has to vanish when Bass and tracers encounter. But then you still have to be analytic in the Bass particles. So basically, if you think for a while, you can only have this such a shape. Let me just put a one here because it doesn't matter, but I could have another parameter here if you like. Okay, so here I've explained this quasi-whole part. This is called Laughlin wave function from the Laughlin, famous Laughlin 83 paper that he got the Nobel Prize for. And quasi-whole because you could think of these ZJs as punching a hole in the density of the Bass particles. Okay, a little bit of notation. This C that I did not explain to you what it is. This C is just a normalization that ensures that if I assume that phi is normalized, then the full wave function is normalized. Okay, I can always do that. I mean, I can always choose the C such that this is true. And then the crucial assumption that I will make. So first assumption is not an assumption. If you are in this space for the Bass particles, you are magnetic kinetic energy is frozen for the bus particles. Then I assume that also the W22 is frozen by this form, and also W12 is frozen. So these are assumptions that you can or cannot justify depending on the context. So I'm assuming that when you act on such an ansatz with your original full Hamiltonian over there, the Hamiltonian just boils down to, so there is a Bn over 2, which is just the lowest Landau level energy of the bus particles, and then I just have only Hm acting on the tracer particles left. Okay, so that's an assumption, and now I can write the claim. Over there, actually. How long is the claim? Yeah, okay, over there. Now the claim is, and that would be a theorem if we knew how to prove it, and we hope in the future months or years we will prove that. So the first claim is what I explained informally, is that psi, this psi here is a good approximation for the true ground state of your Hamiltonian. Okay? I'm saying this vaguely, but that's what we believe in this energy regime. And the second claim is that, well, everything boils down now to understand how the tracer particles behave. So namely, you want to understand that phi. What does that phi do? How should I choose it? And the answer is, so there are assumptions and there are approximations that are not fully justified, but let me tell you the punchline, that if I just compute the energy of that state, psi, the full state, this is an effective, okay, there is a constant, trivial constant, that one, and then plus something which is expectation of value of phi in some effective Hamiltonian. And that effective Hamiltonian is basically that you have over there, with a few twists. That effective Hamiltonian is, so J1 to M, P in the XJ variables, plus E to the minus 1 over N, times the external field. That little n over there, and plus, or rather minus, 1 over n a anion of xj, that squared, where this a anion is the guy over there, this Aronov Bohm-like vector potential. So it's not completely mathematically rigorous yet, but I think it's the main, I think it's really a smoking gun, like experimentalists used to say, to explain that anions can arise in this context because this effective Hamiltonian arises. So just a comment, this here is fractional charge. Because you see that the coupling to the external field of the tracer particles has been reduced by this fraction, 1 over n. And this, okay, as I said, this is the fractional statistics, which is a synonym for anion statistics. So of course, we are certainly not the first to say that this type of quasi-particles, namely this Laughlin quasi-holes, these holes in this wave function here, can behave as anions. I mean, this, as soon basically as the wave function of Laughlin has been written down, people say this. And the most serious argument in this direction is an argument by Arovas, Schrieffer, and Wilczek in 84, where what they said basically is, you freeze the XM variables, they didn't have this, these behave like quantum particles, just classical things. So you just have this form of the function with quasi-holes at the location zj. Now, let me say it vaguely, because it's quite vague in the paper also. Take two of these, move them adiabatically around one another, where adiabatically is not so well defined, but I think you can swallow that, that you can do something, then this wave function picks a wave phase factor e to the I pi minus 1 over n. And then they interpreted this as this is a fractional statistics. So the reason why we wanted to write this claim is that this is really an argument that we could not swallow. I mean, it's certainly very compelling. It tells you, well, something weird is going on, but I don't see why you should identify this Berry phase parameter with the fractional statistics parameter. So that's why we wanted to do this. So now I realize that I don't have really time for part three, because, so I just started 5 minutes late, so I can just maybe take 5 minutes to tell you briefly the content of part three. Yes, let's do that. Yeah, so that I no longer use. Ah. So part three is about, well, this is all well and good. You hope that in some situations anions will emerge. But then what? Suppose I do an experiment. I mean, suppose somebody else does an experiment for me and asks me, how do you spot anions? Well, the truth is, the answer is not easy, because these two Hamiltonians here are really notoriously difficult. I mean, these are really badly interacting Hamiltonians. If you think of the, in terms of bosons, as I do, this is really a very bad interaction for bosons. This is Hamiltonian in singular. It has three-body interactions, two-body interactions that mixes momentum and position. It has all the, basically all the problems you could imagine. So then, can you come up with some approximate theory for this? And that's what we did. I mean, not only us, but we did what is, I think, so far the only mathematically rigorous part of the story. Is in some regime, you obtain an effective description, an effective one-body description. So in 5 minutes, part three, derivation of an effective model with for this, for us in a particular limit. I mean, effective models are valid in some limit. So what is the limit? Let me start from the Hn alpha over there. I mean, the one I had at the end of part one. And so I'm just neglecting this coupling to the external magnetic field, because that's not really the main source of mathematical difficulty. The main source of mathematical difficulty is the anion vector potential. I don't know where I am, 6, 7. Effective model. I'm going to make one small modification to this Hamiltonian. I will define Hn alpha with a parameter r, which is same as Hn alpha, but I replace the A anion of Xj by a smeared version. So namely, I take this as being sum from k not equal to j of nabla perp wr of xj minus xk, where w of x is the Coulomb kernel in 2D, so log mod x, and wr is the same but smeared over a length scale, which is r. So convoluted with something which leaves over the ball of radius r and which has mass 1. So this is to remove a little bit of the singularity of the problem, and also to take into account some things that I don't have time to discuss. So that's my starting point, and I'm interested in, can I have a more wieldy description of the behavior of that guy? And I'm really looking at the ground state. So I'm interested in is in an energy, ground state energy, En alpha r, which is just the infimum of the spectrum of that guy. So the minimal energy I can have in the, for this Hamiltonian. And so let me conclude with a theorem. So you have to do something, you have to take a limit. I want to take a limit which will be familiar to those of you doing mean field theory. I want to take n to infinity. I want to take alpha to be a fixed number beta divided by n minus 1, so divided by n if you like, it's the same. Beta fixed. I want to have the freedom that r goes to 0 when n goes to infinity. So I have a parameter eta that allows me to tune that. So this is the natural scaling regime for reasons that I would have explained if I were not already over time. In this case, provided eta is not too large, so it has to be smaller than a constant that depends on the trapping potential, the potential V, then this ground state energy here converges to a mean field ground state energy, and the effective description will be, now try to find this guy by minimizing the functional that I'm writing right now. E mean field is the infimum of a mean field energy functional of just one function. So I have reduced, as always in mean field models, to just one wave function. So this is the first word. And the form of this energy functional is, so an integral over R2, because it's the one body functional, of minus I nabla plus beta some magnetic vector potential depending on U, this acting on U square, and then I still have the trapping potential V. A of U squared is, as you might expect, you take nabla perp of W. So if you take nabla perp of this W here, the log, you recover this X perp over X squared. That's why I wrote it this way. And this, you convolute with U squared. Okay, I'm going to finish with just one or two comments on this. So the limit problem is still pretty complicated, in particular if you want to do some numerics with it. But it has the huge advantage that it's not many body, it's one body. And it has the huge difference with the usual mean field models, that in usual mean field models you have a self-consistent electric field. I mean, you would have a V here that depends on U. Here, what you have is an effective magnetic field that depends on U. Okay, so it's a magnetic field that is self-consistent, and in fact, if you take the curl of this A, you will see that the effective magnetic field is proportional to U squared, so it's proportional to the matter density. Okay, so this is the effective model we came up with so far. So of course, this is something that was around more or less in the physics literature, and in this part, what we provide is really the rigorous proof of this theorem. Okay, now I thank you for your attention.
So if I understand it correctly, this could give you a billion anions with any phase. But what about the non-abelian anions? Is there any room in this description for non-abelian anions?
That I don't know, because first thing, for the non-abelian anions, I don't think I've ever seen in the literature what should be the effective Hamiltonian. I mean, you know, I mean, you know, people have descriptions of non-abelian anions, but I don't think I saw them written as just you have a bosonic field and then you act on it with a weird Hamiltonian. So maybe this is written down somewhere, I don't know, or maybe you could cook it up from this Berry phase calculation that they do. But and then I'm not sure I understand what are the physical requirements to have a non-abelian anion. I mean, in this context, you should, I mean, another thing which is left unsaid in this is that, okay, our derivation here is not rigorous, but the reason we choose this case is that we hope someday that it will be rigorous. And in particular, this first claim that psi is an approximate ground state, you have a good hope to make it rigorous, because you see this this guy is a real good candidate to be an exact ground state of point-like interactions. Whereas for the non-Abelianians, I mean, there are exact ground states on some weird interactions, three-body, things like that. So I'm not really sure what is the physics that goes in there. Yeah, in one here. The microphone is coming. Yes.
Why are these particles called anions?
Maybe I said it too fast. Anions is any ions.
Really?
Yeah, so it's just any thing. I mean, you have firm ions, bosons, and any ions. I mean, they can have any statistics. It's a Vilcek coined the name, actually. It's Vilcek to call it the name.
Let's speak again.